So where we're standing right now is Puako, which many people around the state think of as one of the healthiest reefs that we have here in Hawaii, except it's a shadow of what it used to be.
Back in the 1800s, this whole mountain was covered with sandalwood. And during the sandalwood trade, it got all taken away and then used for ranching. So we have a huge goat problem here. As they just congregate here and trample on the land and eat everything in sight, it causes these barren areas here, which create a lot more erosion.
And so when the rain comes, then that runoff then is going to carry the soil with it out into the ocean.
And then it washes down onto the reef and smothers the coral. So you have instant mortality of the corals that are covered.
So our long-term goal is to actually look at this. How do we take care of this land for the future generations? How do we protect our watershed?
Among the many unique features of West Hawaii Island are one of the state's highest concentrations of fish ponds and one of the longest contiguous coral reefs. It's also one of the fastest growing areas in Hawaii, attracting development and tourism to its fine beaches and resorts. In response, many groups have been working to understand, preserve, and restore these systems. And in 2014, the West Hawaii Habitat Focus Area was established, bringing together governments, universities, NGOs, and local communities in a consolidated effort.
The Habitat Blueprint Program and NOAA's involvement has really catalyzed us to work harder, to communicate better, to share information, and to work together.
And the reason that we're really focused on corals is because we're talking about coral reef ecosystems. Without the coral, you're essentially chopping that ecosystem off at its knees. So one of the leading hypotheses for why that coral cover has declined over time is input of nutrients from land, primarily from an increasing human population and human wastewater seeping into the nearshore coral reef system.
With coral reefs in such close proximity to a developing coastline, efforts are progressing to educate homeowners about these issues, and communities are working together to find solutions, like improving sewer systems. Further upland, efforts are also underway to contain sediment from the once forested lands.
We are in the middle of the Kauai Watershed, and it's about 70,000 acres and runs from the ocean to the top of Kohala Mountains.
An area that was really heavily degraded due to past vegetation loss. So we're out here trying to revegetate the mountain back to its native forest.
In the past 5 years, this watershed has transformed from a barren wasteland of red dirt to a thriving young forest. The main reason is because it was fenced, keeping out the goats. Such restoration efforts are also planned elsewhere in the watershed, but with lots more barren land around, some quicker fixes are needed.
This is a sediment catching dam made with just rocks, shade cloth, and wire. And this is to hold together so when the water comes down, we're trying to catch the fine sediment from going into the ocean.
Another major component of the habitat focus area is to restore fish ponds that were built by the Hawaiian people as a form of traditional aquaculture. Today, community members remove invasive plants that are choking the pond and hindering productivity.
It's really important to restore fish ponds because they're an extension of coastal habitat. They represent the estuaries for West Hawaii. Our goal here at Kiholo is to have production from the fish pond to feed the people who are working on it. We know that this can happen. It's happened 50 years ago when the fish pond was a managed system. So it's an exciting time.
The more restoration that happens now, the more resilient West Hawaii will be, not only to future development, but unforeseen events like wildfires and flash floods. In 2015, the reefs also experienced their first major coral bleaching event on record, likely due to record high ocean temperatures along the coast. If the stressors coming from runoff and invasive species are not alleviated, there's concern about how well the corals will be able to recover in the future.
So hopefully it's an eye-opener to everyone that if we really want to continue to protect our reefs, we have to manage on the land.
In 10 years, if we continue these efforts, we're going to see cleaner water, we're going to see more coral, we're going to see more fish. And those benefits are going to be observed by everyone who utilizes the coral reefs and spends time in the water, which will build the case for doing similar work in other places.